to you guys real quick. Oh, there I am. Hi. I was like, I'm projected. I'll make it bounce off the back wall. We'll do it. Hello again, if anybody didn't hear that happen, by the way. I'm up here. My name is Joey Clark. I'm the youth minister here. I'm going to talk to you guys real quick about something we're doing this Saturday. We're doing our Valentine's dinner and dessert auction, which goes to fundraise for the youth and our mission trip this summer. We're going to be helping in the flood victims in Kentucky this year. We're going to be taking a group of high schoolers and college kids and just anybody that kind of wants to come, and we're going to be doing a lot of work and getting dirty and helping people and just doing whatever they need us to do in that area. Saturday, we're going to be having a pasta dinner with salad and breadsticks and just lots of really good food. The kids will be your waiters. We are going to start a new thing this year where we're going to have like a tipping challenge to see which table can get the highest tips. All those tips will go towards the fundraiser. Nobody's going to pocket any money, hopefully. Children, I'm watching you. But it's just going to kind of help them to give the best service possible. Don't just throw money at them, Dad, wherever you are. I know it's just going to be sticking, oh, they gave me an ice cube, here's a dollar. Like, just, you know, make them work for it, you know what I'm saying? And then after dinner, we'll play some games, some Family Feud, newlywed style stuff. And then we'll have our dessert auction. And normally that is a really good fundraiser. It's really fun. Everybody just kind of spends a ridiculous amount of money on peanut butter pies and that kind of stuff. And again, all the money, all the proceeds go to the Mission Fund. It'll be a really fun event. I hope to see all of you there. There's going to be a sign-up sheet out on the table out front. If you would like to come, just sign up. And then if you would like to bring a dessert for the dessert auction, there's also a sign-up sheet for that. So I really hope to see all of you there. It'll be a really fun time. Thank you very much. I'll turn it back over to the worship team.
It's good to see you this morning, church. Are you glad to be here? Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How about we stand to worship our God this morning, because there is nothing that our God can't do.
Oh, praise the name that made.
through Christ who strengthens me. It's not we that can do it. It's God that gives us the strength to do it, because there's nothing that He can't do.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree.
Like to be seated, you can. If you would like to remain standing, you can do that however you feel that you worship the best. Do it again. This song talks about he's never failed me yet. And God, let me get this out here. God has never failed, and He never will. We fail all the time, but God has never failed, and He never will. This morning, as we sing Do It Again, we believe in God and that He can do it again, and He can take this country back to where it was if we, the church, will stand up and believe and what His Word says. And Brother Jim's going to tell us about that this morning. So let's sing Do It Again this morning.
Still in your hands, this is my confidence.
Going to talk about what we believe this morning. What do we believe? Do we just believe what everybody else tells us? Do we believe what the Bible says? Do we believe what the plan of salvation says? that we must believe, repent, confess, be immersed, and then live that Christian life. Do we believe that? Or is it just something that we hear that we think we believe? Do we show what we believe every single day in our lives? I can tell you right now, we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and He's coming back again one of these days. So let's sing about that this morning.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe. We believe. Broken generation, when all is dark, You help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again.
Good morning, church family. It's good to see all of you here today. Is there anybody that didn't get a communion cup this morning? If you didn't, hold your hand up and we'll have somebody bring you some. Look good. Okay. So to start this communion meditation, I want you to ponder these words. God is love. All right. So I'm going to read out of 1 John 4:7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. By this, the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this love, now that we love God, in this is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. So God sent his Son because he loved us so much, and he knows we're sinful people. And through the sacrificial system in the old times where they sacrificed lambs, sheep, goats, and all that, your sin was paid for right when it was done. Christ came to the earth and paid the ultimate sacrifice. He paid the sacrifice to cover all sin for the rest of our lives until we go to heaven to be with him, right? So as we partake of communion, which is open to all baptized believers, think about the cost that was paid just for us so that we could have eternal life with Christ. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just love you so much and thank you for your love for us, Lord. Help us to learn to love one another and to lift one another be bold in what we do for you, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for your mercy, grace, and love that you show us, that you sent your Son to die on a cross for our sins, Lord. It's a gift we don't deserve. But Lord, as we remember what you did for us, help us to open our hearts and minds to that and tell others about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of you. Lord, we love you and we thank you so much. It's in Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Morning, church. It's hard to think that a preacher would be grateful that half the congregation leaves before the church starts. But it's great that we have kids that we do, isn't it? Amen. So I want to start a sermon series this morning. And I told the guys yesterday morning, I have never audibly heard God speak to me. But he's been speaking to my heart about this series I want to do for some time. And I pray that we take it in the love that it's meant to be given. We don't hear me, you hear the Lord speak to us. There's three verses that I'm going to use off and on as we go through this. And if you have your Bibles, you know what I'm going to say. You should have your Bibles. Go to Acts chapter 16 with me for a moment. And this is part of an encounter that we read about. But I want to just take this one particular verse because I believe that's what a lot of people do. Acts chapter 16 verse 31 says this. They said, being Paul and Silas, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. That's it. Believe and be saved. If you will, go to Romans in chapter 10, verse 9. Again, I want to use just this verse. It says this to us, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. There you go. One more time. A verse that we all know. But still, I'd like for you to open your Bibles and look at it. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Three passages of Scripture that tell us basically, if you believe, you'll be saved. What do you think about that? Is it that simple? Do we just confess with our mouth and know in our hearts that Jesus is Jesus? We're good? Since we're all good people, since we're all in church on Sunday mornings when we could be doing other things, apparently we must be believers, right? And if we're believers and then we're in church, then surely we're Christian, right? I'm going to make a statement, and I hope I get some fallout from it. I hope people talk to me about it. I truly believe that it's possible, probable, even here, that there are people who profess to believe in Jesus Christ that don't know who he is. And if that's true, he doesn't know who you are. Think about that. I can back it up. Take your Bibles and go to Matthew chapter 7, verse 23. It says this. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. But you say, well, how can that be? God loves everybody. God wants to save everybody. John 3:16 said that God so loved the world, he sent his son to save us, right? And surely God is all love, and God doesn't want anybody to be lost. God loves the sinners. He hates the sin, but he loves the sinners, right? That's what we say. Go with me to Psalm 5. I'll give you a minute. I want you to read this. Psalm 5, I want to read verses 4 through 6. Psalm 5, 4 says, for you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness, nor evil, no evil dwells within you. The boastful shall not stand before your eyes. You hate all who do iniquity. You destroy those who speak falsehood. The Lord abhors the man of bloodshed and deceit. Family, what is iniquity? Sin. When you commit sin, what are you? So what's this saying to us? Maybe we're not entitled. Maybe we don't deserve. Maybe we don't believe like we think we do. So here's what I want you to do. One more scripture, and then we'll start getting into the series. Go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5, and let's read what that says. Paul, writing to the church in Corinth, says these words in 13:5. Test yourself to see if you are in the faith. Examine yourselves. Or do you not recognize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail the test? So what do we believe? Pray with me. Father, I'm excited about what we're about to do. Lord, I pray with everything in me that we hear you speak to us today. And we dedicate ourselves to examine ourselves, to test and see if we're truly in the faith or if we're somewhere else doing something else, thinking we're doing what you would have us do. Lord, I pray that you give us wisdom and discernment. I pray, Father, for discipline, even conviction, to the point to where we come to that place to where we realize when we stand face to face before you that everything changes. Lord, help us to see that. Help us to desire that. Help us to believe. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Top of your outline, you should have four questions. And I want to go over those briefly with you. First it says, do you believe in Jesus Christ? And it says, the first thing says, I believe. What do you believe? Think just for a minute. What is it you believe? I believe in Jesus Christ. Well, what is that? Secondly, what does it mean? You know, when we have someone join the church or we have someone that is baptized and they give their life to the Lord, we stand in front of the family and we make this profession. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, my Lord and Savior. That's beautiful. But what's it mean to you? How deep does it go? How far does it reach? Then thirdly, because of my belief and what it means to me, the result is what? What do you do with it? And lastly, and now I, what do you do? What do you believe? What's it mean to you? What's the impact? What's the result? And what are you doing with it? Have you ever thought that deeply about what you believe? Or do we just say, well, I believe in Jesus. I believe he's the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross to save me from my sins. And? Does it stop there? You see, what a lot of folks believe is, and you hear it often, to believe means that I have prayed a prayer, I have signed a card, I have joined a church, and now I go to heaven. That's what it means. I made a copy of what is commonly called the sinner's prayer. I want to read this to you. It says, Dear God, I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask you to please forgive my sin. I believe in my heart that Jesus is your Son, that he died for me on the cross, and you raised him back to life. Jesus, I declare that you are my God, and I open my heart to you. Change me and help me to follow you all the days of my life. Help me to be more like you and do your will. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Do you realize what you're saying when you say that prayer? Do you realize what it is you're committing yourself to? Do you realize what it is you're asking God to do in your life? What a lot of folks do, they pray that prayer and then they say, you are now a believer. You're now a Christian. You're going to heaven. I've got a problem with that. And I want to share some thoughts with you. And I want you to follow along with me. And you'll notice at the bottom of your outline, I put my email address there. I don't usually do that. But if you have questions or comments or something you would like to talk about as we go through this series that's on your heart, send it to me. And we'll address it. Because I'll tell you the truth, family. I love each and every one of you so much. I don't want any of us to miss this. It's eternally powerful in your lives. It will determine your eternal destiny. What we say we believe and what we do about that belief. Because as I said, I believe, I truly do, maybe even in this church, there are people who profess to be believers, who profess to be Christians, who profess to be disciples, and they do not know Jesus Christ. And it's time we did. Minister that I grew up with, he said he preached three kinds of sermons. He preached front porch sermons. And what that was, I don't know if you all remember, but a long time ago, houses used to have big front porches and people would walk by your neighborhood. You'd yell at each other and say hi to each other. And that kind of a sermon is to the people that are out there. Go take the message to people that are out there. Then you had living room sermons where you'd invite people in and you'd all come together and you'd talk about things. But he said the third kind, and this is what I just flashed back to when we were doing this, he has kitchen table sermons. That's where you take your Bible, you take a pen and a paper, and you lay it out on the table, and you let the Bible speak to you, and then you go out into the world believing the message that comes to you from God through his complete, perfect word. And that belief drives you out into the world. That's what I want us to do with the study that we're going to do here for the next few weeks. So those four questions that I ask you, I didn't give you a lot of time because what I want you to do is, as Mark said earlier, I like that word, I want you to ponder this. This week, I want you to take those four questions home. And based on what we go through here this morning and what we're going to go through, I want those words, those questions to constantly be in your mind and in your heart. And you actually listen with your heart to what God is saying through his word to you about your belief. And we begin to form our true belief system that the Lord would want us to have. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, it says this about our belief. If anyone is in Christ, he's a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. First thing that I believe happens when you believe in Jesus Christ, you come face to face with God. And you cannot walk away unaffected. C.S. Lewis said that. I heard it said this week. I was listening to some messages. And it said, if you were to walk out into the interstate and get hit by a semi-truck, that would have an impact on your life. You reckon? In our spiritual life, when we come face to face with the Lord God, that has an impact on our life. And we make one of two choices. We either accept him or we reject him. There is no middle lane. There is no gray area. You either give your life to the Lord or you don't. You either believe or you don't. And that's the only two choices that you have. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, we read these words. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction, and there are many who enter through it. For the gate is small and the way is narrow that leads to life, and there are few who find it. When we have a belief in Jesus Christ, as I said, everything changes. We want to live for him. we love him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We begin to see people differently. We love our neighbor like we love ourselves. We begin to realize we're all sinners. We all fall short. We begin to forgive each other. We all realize that we go through struggles. We all encourage each other. We realize that we're called to go out into all the world with the gospel message. We begin to witness and share the gospel with other people. Everything changes, and the closer we draw to the Lord, the more we believe in him, the more the world just begins to float away. In Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, we've shared this a lot lately. It says this: "Therefore I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect." Our life no longer follows the world. We don't follow the broad gate. We see the narrow gate that goes to the Lord. And the majority of people who worship themselves and other things, their focus is not on God. Ours is. And so as we begin to live that life, we begin to live a life of worship and of service to God. And as we do that, we begin to see his will in our lives played out. And that's what we want more of. And again, the world just continues to go away. The old has gone. The new has come. And we see that we are that new creation in Christ. And other people see it in us too. And they want it. In Acts chapter 11 and verse 26, it said the Christians were first, the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. They didn't tell everybody they were Christians. The world called them Christians. We proclaim that we're Christians. And I wonder, who else calls us Christians? By the way we live our lives, by the belief that we have in Christ, by the dedication and the life that we live for him, that Jesus himself said that they will know you are mine by the love that you have for each other. How many people actually see that in us based on our professed belief? What do you think? So what has your belief in Christ changed in you? Next, what does your belief in Christ involve? You see, does your belief, we said earlier, we believe, so does that default to Christianity? Are we Christians because we believe? James 2:19 says, you believe that God is one, that's good. The demons also believe, and they shudder. So by our logic, by what we're saying here, the demons are Christian. Make sense? No, it doesn't make sense. That's nuts. But let me ask you this. Why do they shudder? Because they know the sovereign authority of God. They know that Christ changes lives. They know that they're defeated. They know that there's victory in Jesus. They know all those things, and it scares them to death. We know all those things and don't talk about it. We just kind of, oh, yeah, I know. So do you think that our involvement in our belief makes a difference? Do we just take that sinner's prayer, or do we just take that church card, or do we just take that statement that I believe and put it in my back pocket as my get out of hell card, and when the time comes for me to be judged, I'll say, oh, I can't do it. I said a prayer once. I said I believed in you. I professed. Depart from me. I never knew you. But Lord, I did all these things. Don't know who you are. Do you realize that that's not just the catchy phrase in Scripture? That's going to happen to people. And I don't want that to happen to us. I don't want us to stand before God someday and say, well, oh, I thought that meant. No, I want us in the Word. I want us together. I want us studying. I want us to be approved, a workman, unashamed, ready to give an account of the defense of our faith in season and out of season. I want us to be so full of God that we overflow and everybody knows it. That's what he's calling us to be. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 21, it says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." That's belief. Does your belief in the Lord, is that your purpose to live? And to realize that when this life is over, it gets even better? Do you believe that? You see what we do, and we've said this before. Yes, I believe that. Yes, I'm a Christian. You going to heaven? I hope so. Scripture tells us there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We are given the Holy Spirit that seals the deal, if you will, to live inside of us, to guide us and comfort us, to correct us, to direct us, to recall to us all the things that we have learned from God in Scripture. So that we don't fall, so that we don't get tempted, so that we're stronger in our faith, and it continues to grow as we grow. But again, we want to follow the world. If we truly believed, we wouldn't. This past week, some amazing things happened, and I want you to think about it. Last Sunday night, all the celebrities in the country came to a party where they were going to give the awards to the best performances, to the best artists. And they call it the Grammy Awards. And I didn't see it, but I read accounts and saw clips. Do you know what they did there? They worshiped Satan. Flat out. The performance was called Unholy. And they were just acclaimed and just worshiped for what they did. That's the world we're in today. And not 50 miles down the road from us at Asbury College, they had a service that lasted over a week and revival took up there. We didn't hear much about that. But you see, God is still God. Truth is still truth. The wide gate that everybody is taking leads to hell. The narrow gate, the believers will be rewarded and said, "Well done, good and faithful," what? Servant. Because we serve a victorious, all-powerful God. And we just kind of play with that. Tonight, there's going to be a football game. Go Chiefs. There will be thousands of people spending millions of dollars traveling from all over the place to watch two teams beat each other to death, to have a trophy and a ring and a claim for a year. 2-3 years from now, we won't remember who won the game, won't remember the game. But they will come together and worship their team. For what purpose? And don't get me wrong, I love football. But it doesn't save my soul. The other side of the coin, this week I read several accounts from athletes who are playing in the Super Bowl, and they give God glory first among all, above everything. They thank their Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for the opportunity they have to be given the platform they have to have an influence that they wouldn't otherwise have so that people can know Jesus Christ. You see, the world is looking for all kinds of things. But if you look deep enough and you open your eyes wide enough, you can see God's hand on everything that takes place in this world. Because he's in control. Because he's sovereign. And he wants a relationship with you and me. And if you will believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he will save you. So the question is your life marked by Jesus Christ? Do you really know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? There's some six things here, six passages of Scripture. You'll see them on your outline. And I want you to take a moment and just go back to those four questions just for a minute. Think about them. Think about your belief, how deep your belief really is. And if it ends at just professing Jesus as Christ, what do you do about these things? Go to Psalm 46:10. Psalm 46:10 says, "Cease striving and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." What he's saying to us here, this is the Eastern Kentucky translation. Shut up and listen to me. Quit fighting me. Don't think you're all that. Realize who it is you are. Realize who it is I am. Just sit there for a minute and ponder that. And I believe, family, if we see God truly as God, Creator, Savior, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and we see us as his creation, I hope that you'll come to the same conclusion I did, and your core theology becomes God is God and I am not. And from there, we can begin to build a relationship. No, I don't have control. No, I don't have the ability. No, I can't do everything. But you're God. You're all powerful. You can do anything. And you are offering me the opportunity to accept your gift of salvation and forgiveness for my sins that I can't do on my own. Then we can start to realize who we are, who he is, and what can be accomplished. And that will start us on the path of a true belief in Jesus Christ. What do you do with this next one? Look at Acts 3:19. 3:19 says, "Therefore, repent and return so that your sins may be wiped away in order that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord." You ever been forgiven for something? Husbands? Surely not. We've never asked forgiveness from our wives for anything. But when we do, and we're forgiven, kind of refreshing, isn't it? What about the guilt and the shame for the sins that we have accumulated over the years in our lives? What if we could be forgiven all that and the old be done away with and replaced with a new life? Wouldn't that be refreshing? That's what this is. But if our belief stops at just saying, well, God is God, I believe in Jesus Christ, do we realize that that belief involves forgiveness for our sins, a new spirit within us, a new life in us? Corey Ten Boom said that God takes all your sins, throws them in the lake, and puts up a no fishing sign. Nobody can touch them again. Scripture says they're taken as far away as the east is from the west. There is no scoreboard. They never come up again. We don't need to continue to carry all that guilt and shame because the Lord sent Christ to die on the cross, so we don't have them anymore. He took them with him to the grave. We're not under that condemnation anymore. Isn't that refreshing? Could we really believe that? That's what belief is about. Your sins can be forgiven. You can have a new life. Your past can be gone. We don't have to follow that anymore. We just read, don't be taken by the world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind in Christ. Listen to what he says. Not what the world says. Not what Satan says. Because what he's going to say is, I can forgive you for most stuff. But you remember that one thing? Uh-uh. Never going to happen. Get behind me, Satan. I follow the Lord. He says I'm good. I'm good. Do we believe that? Here's another thought. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word's not in us. It's kind of a double whammy. If we confess our sins, he'll forgive us our sins. If we say we don't have them, we're saying he can't do it. We're saying he's a liar. If we truly believe in the Lord as the Lord, don't we realize that his word, he never failed us yet, as they sang earlier, he will never fail us. Do we really believe that? Then here's one that I think we miss a lot. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that's not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that one may boast. No, we are not entitled to forgiveness. No, God will not take us to heaven just because we're good people. No, God will not work for us. God will not do what we want him to do. He has offered us everything we need to have what we don't deserve, what we haven't earned. Why? Because he's patient with us, because he loves us. But there will come a time when that love and that patience will end. And we need to recognize that, and we need to believe that with all our hearts. We keep pushing off and putting back and making excuses for not coming to the Lord the way we should. We don't realize his mercy and his grace because our belief has stopped with that prayer. It stopped with that, I believe that God is God and God is good and I'm good, so I'm going to heaven. And that's as deep as we get in our doctrine. And so when we have things like this come up, we don't know what to do with them. It's because we don't believe who God is. We don't know Jesus Christ. When it says here in the last part of the verse, not as a result of works, so that one may boast, you don't work your way into heaven. You do good works as evidence of the salvation God has given to you by his grace and mercy. It's because that's who you now are. It's not who you want to try to be and try to accomplish and try to work your way into. It's a gift that he's given to you. And we need to see that and exhibit that for the world to see. This is how good God is. I want to love other people. I want to forgive other people. I want you to know about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because it changed my life, it will change your life too. And I know for a fact, everybody in here knows somebody that needs to know the Lord. But we're so concerned, because our belief system is so shallow, we're more concerned about us going to heaven, thinking we have to do more good than bad to weigh the scales out in our favor, that we're missing the opportunity to witness to people all over the place. Our focus is off because our belief is off. And that's why we do the things that we do. I got ahead of myself. Let's go to the next one. We'll come back to it. Go to Mark 16:16. A major belief issue. Mark 16:16, Jesus himself is saying these words. He who has believed and has been baptized shall be saved. But he who disbelieved shall be condemned. We believe that Jesus is Jesus. We believe that he's the Lord. We believe in all that the scripture says, but we don't want to be baptized because we really don't see the reason. Don't see the relevance. Don't see the importance. Well, let me ask you this. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Do you believe that his word is perfect? Do you believe that He said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If we know the Lord to be the Lord, and he says, if you believe and you be baptized, you'll be saved. Why in the world would you draw a line in the sand there and say, nope, don't need it? I'm going to let that sink in a minute. Time after time, in the passage in Acts 16:31 that we started off with this evening, that's this morning, that's the account of Paul and Silas and the jailer. And the jailer comes to him and says, what must I do to be saved? And he told him. And if you keep reading the next verse or two, it says, and immediately he was baptized, him and his whole household. Why would he do that? Paul didn't say you need to be baptized. He said, believe in the Lord and you'll be saved. Why would the guy be baptized? The same reason it bothers you that you haven't been. Because the Holy Spirit spoke to his heart. And in full obedience, he wanted to be as close to the Lord as he could. He wanted to be in the kingdom as deep as he could be. And so everything that he knew he had to do, he did and more if he could. Why do we stop at mere profession of Jesus? Do you want to go to heaven? I'll tell you, my belief, baptism in and of itself does not save you. I can put you in that tank 10 times. And if your heart isn't right, if you're not doing it for the reason that you should be doing it, you're just getting wet. But if you have given your heart to the Lord, you want to join him in death, burial, resurrection, in a newness of life. And you want the world to know that. And you want the Lord to know that. And more importantly, you want to have that. That's why you do it. So for you to say, well, I don't think I need it. Do you know Jesus Christ? Do you know what it is he wants for you? Do you know what it is he's telling you to do? Why don't you believe enough to act? One more. Go to Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Matthew 28, verse 18 says, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Pick your feet up. I'm going to step on your toes. Over a year ago, we started a discipleship study so that we could be better disciples to fulfill the Great Commission, to go out into all the world and make disciples. Beyond that, I'm betting that there are people here who have been calling yourself a believer, a Christian, a disciple, for years, and you have never told the first soul about Jesus Christ. Why is that? Well, they might ask a question. Well, they might call me a name. They might not be my friend anymore. I may make them mad. But you know what the Lord said about that? They will. You know why they do it? They will. Because they did it to me first, he said. They'll hate you because they hated me first. Would you rather be in the company of the Lord or in the company of the world? Would you rather have friends and you all go to hell? Or would you take that narrow path? Would be transformed by the renewing of your heart? Will you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Will you believe him? Because you will answer to him. You won't answer to them. How deep do you believe? What is it calling you to do? What changes have taken place in your life? What have you picked up that you didn't before? What have you put away that you haven't before? Because Christ has come into your life and changed everything. Take your Bibles and go back to John 3:16. I want to close with this. But I want you to open your Bibles. I want you to take your ink pens or pens or crayons or whatever it is you use. And when we come to some words in here, I want you to highlight those or circle those, because we have read this over and over and over, but I've come across a line of reasoning and thinking that, to me, opens this verse up and hits you right between the eyes. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. First word I want you to take a look at is believe. Wayne Grudem, in his book Systematic Theology, defines it this way. Belief, not just belief. Note the result of the belief. Whoever believes in him, what? Shall not perish, but have eternal life. Not just, I believe, but because I believe, I have this. Freed from condemnation, receiving eternal life, and entering into a relationship of total honesty with the Father. Total honesty with the Father. What that means is, when we say we believe, when we try to put up that Christian front so other people see it, so they'll think that we're Christians, so we look good in their eyes, God knows your heart. He knows that doesn't work. He knows your belief is not where it needs to be, and could very well say, I don't know who you are. Because we're not putting our faith in the Lord. We're putting our faith in the lie that Satan has given to us and living by that, that broad gate. That's what he wants. But true belief frees us from the condemnation. We receive eternal life and we're placed into an honest relationship with the Lord where he knows our heart. And if we will talk to him and ask him whatever we ask in accordance with his will, he will give us. And for this study, for where we are now, I pray that we ask for wisdom and discernment and direction and to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And he'll do that. And he'll open our eyes to where we can see where our belief system really lies and what it is he's called us to. Another word that they pick out here is eternal life. Think about this with me. Circle eternal life in your Bible. It says that this refers not only to the duration of our existence, but to the quality of that life in contrast to the futility of mortal life. Eternal life is a deepening and continually growing experience. It cannot be exhausted in any measurable span of time, but introduces a totally new quality of life. What that means is, when do you think, as a Christian, our eternity begins? When we stand before the Lord and he says, well done, good and faithful servant, now eternity begins. Our new life with the Lord begins. Is that what you think? That's what most people do, because we tie everything to now, here, our mortal life. What do we have now? It's going to get better later. This says we receive eternal life when we receive Jesus Christ. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. When? Doesn't say have eternal life at death, at physical death. No. I believe that Jesus is Christ, Son of the living God, my Savior. Your eternal life begins. Not that old way, the new has come. A new life in Christ where we don't have guilt and shame and remorse. It starts all over again, and it doesn't end when we end. It never ends. As a matter of fact, it does nothing but continue to grow. A deeper, fuller, happier, more joyful, victorious, eternal life. How often do we think that way here now? We say, boy, I wish the Lord had come back. Family, if you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he's here. He's in you. There's victory in that. There's joy in that. Even to the point that when we face trials and tribulations, we can rejoice. Because we know what's going to happen. Do we really believe that? And then lastly, the last word, circle the word perish. And think about this. It's the opposite of salvation. It is to fail completely in fulfilling God's purpose and consequently to be forever excluded from his fellowship. Used here, it clearly implies, listen, those without God are hopelessly confused in purpose, alienated from him in the affections, and futile in their efforts. What's the world doing right now? I don't know who I am. I don't know what I'm supposed to be. God must have made a mistake when he made me. I'll try to find happiness over here, over there, or wherever else. I'll do whatever it is I need to do to find what I can find until that doesn't work anymore. Then I'll go somewhere else and try something else anymore. And I don't know why everybody hates everybody, and I don't know why things are the way they are. There you go. The world will perish. It's showing signs of death now. But a person in Christ has eternal life. We're not part of that world. That's not our home. That's not where we belong. We already have an eternal life in the presence of God all the time. We know for certain who we are. We know what it is we're supposed to do. We have joy in knowing that who we belong to. We don't have to search anymore. He's here. He's here. And he knows what it is he wants for us. And if we live for him, we can continue to see him put all of these things in place for us, Romans, where we can see his good will playing out in our lives. What more could we want to be assured of God's presence? What more do you need to see to believe? So as we go through this study, what I wanted to do this morning, the thing I hope that I did, was cause you to think, to question some things. Go back to those four questions, because you're going to see them again on your outline next week and probably the next week. Look for the answers. Send me some emails. Do whatever you need to do and want to do to where you begin to come into the presence of the Lord and see what belief really looks like. Take your Bibles and go to Mark chapter 9. And in Mark chapter 9, verses 22 through 24, this is the account of a young boy who had been possessed by demons. And he was constantly throwing himself into fire. He was being tortured and abused. And his father brought him to the disciples, and the disciples couldn't do anything with him. And the father was totally destroyed. He was distraught. Put yourself in that situation. The love that you have for your child who's possessed by the devil, and nobody can do anything for you. What would your belief system look like? Jesus comes on the scene. And the father, it says, and he asked his father, Jesus in verse 21, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. Then the father says this, it has often thrown him both into the fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. Can you identify with that? Even though we say we believe, even though we say we're Christians, even though we say that we follow the Lord, are you being beat up? Are you going through things right now? And you're not really sure if you believe or you don't, but you hear that Jesus can fix anything. And so you come to him and say, if you can do anything. Look at what Jesus says, verse 23. And Jesus said to him, if you can? All things are possible to him who believes. Look at your life. Look at your belief system. Look at what the Lord wants for you. And read that again. All things are possible to him who believes. What does that mean to you? What do you think that could mean to you if we truly believed the way he calls us to believe. Then verse 24. Immediately the boy's father cried out and said, I do believe. Help my unbelief. Family, I believe that's the church today. We believe. God help us. Because we don't believe enough to believe in him. We want to do it our way. We want to do what the world says to do. We want to take that broad gate. We want to not be transformed but blend in to the world. So we try to worship in a way that we can kind of have a little bit of the world, a little bit of the Lord, and all things work together. And then we wonder why God isn't working. We wonder why our belief isn't deep enough. It's because we need help with our unbelief. In just a minute, we're going to have our invitational hymn. And what I would like for you to do, what I pray that we'll do, realize, don't play games with this. Look at yourself, just like we read to begin with. Test yourself. Examine yourself. See where you are. See if you are really in the faith, or do we fail the test? And realize that as long as we are here, God is patient and he is kind and he will help us. Whatever we ask in his name, he'll do for us. Do you think that maybe you don't know Jesus Christ? You know the church. You know what a Bible is. But we don't read it. We don't pray. We don't ask God to do anything. And now maybe that we come to the reality that we've been playing games all this time. Lord, if you can do anything, help me. And realize that he will. And then come to that point where we can say, help my unbelief. Knowing that he will. But that involves more than just signing a card and praying a prayer. It requires your heart. Your life. And that's where we're going to go the next 2-3 weeks. Bit by bit. Little by little. And we're going to try to come back to the Lord the way we should. And be the people he's called us to be. And have the belief system that now we realize is much more than just making a statement. Pray with me. Father, it's my prayer here that we take the time to look at ourselves. Examine ourselves. And that we start right now. Just to be still and know that you're God. That we look at the questions. What do I believe? What does that mean? What's the result of that? And what do I do with it now? Lord, help us to take those home and pray over them. Talk with each other about them. Look for help. Help us to see other people are doing the same thing. This is not just us. Lord, we're a church that wants to be closer to you so we can have more of an impact on the community around us. We want to be those workers that go out into the fields. But Lord, our belief needs some work. So Father, pick us up. Love on us. Help us grow. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Would you stand with us this morning as we sing our invitation, Mighty to Save? If you don't know who Jesus is as your personal Savior, you can do that this morning. Jim's laid it out there for you. All you have to do is come forward and make that first step as we sing this morning.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me.
Glad to be here this morning and say amen.
Amen.
We've certainly been challenged about our belief. Now let's take that away from here and don't just leave it here. Let's take it away from here and show people that we do believe. Don't forget what's going on this week Wednesday night and tonight with Bible study. Wednesday night we have midweek classes, youth classes, all kinds of stuff going on. And Saturday, the big event for Valentine's Day for the youth. Come out and support them, make a cake for the or a pie or whatever for the dessert auction, and show our youth that how much we love them and support them. Anything else we need to mention before we go? All right, let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for the opportunity to come and worship you this morning. I pray, God, this morning that as we've been challenged about our belief and about believing, if there's someone here this morning who hasn't made that decision to be immersed into Christ, they don't leave this place because, God, we know the invitation's not closed because service is done. That invitation's open anytime. I pray this morning that as we leave this place that you go with us and direct our path. May we look to you every day for strength and for nourishment in our faithfulness. We love you so much and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody have a great day.